We are back to do another deep dive into a major Walking Dead character. This week, we're focusing on the series' first big bad, the Governor, who's the reason I wear an eye patch and drive a tank. That said, thanks to a totally innocent misunderstanding with the California Highway Patrol, I am no longer allowed to drive the tank while wearing the eye patch. Such is life. I'm Woody Tondorf, and this is I See Dead People. Brian Blake, also known as the Governor for his semi-problematic Arnold Schwarzenegger impression, first arrived to the Walking Dead comics in issue 27, which came out in 2006. You know, the year Hannah Montana premiered, Googlebot YouTube, and Borat was killing it at the box office.
Very nice!
You know what else is very nice? This backstory, told in a separate but canonical novel, The Rise of the Governor. In the book, we learn Brian was a frail guy who wore Weezer and REM shirts while studying comparative literature at the University of Georgia. A failed businessman, Brian gets divorced and moves back in with his parents. Once the apocalypse hits, he joins a survival group led by his younger brother Philip, who is much cooler, and can smoke, and knows when to cool it with the Borat voice. They get attacked by a gang, and Philip's daughter Penny gets shot and killed. Still, Philip decides to keep her alive as a zombie pet. Later, they make it to Woodbury, a town of survivors run by the National Guard. Philip takes a girl into the woods to kill her and turn her into penny food, but his friend Nick stops him and ends up shooting Philip and the girl. Brian gets in on the action and kills Nick as Philip dies in his arms. A little later, Brian has an out-of-body experience where he envisions himself as his brother, and afterwards decides to go straight up talented Mr. Ripley and take on the identity of Philip Blake. He kills the leader of Woodbury, creates a fighting ring, puts heads in fish tanks, and generally convinces his new followers that they're the good guys.
Sure, Jam.
You know, maybe this is less talented Mr. Ripley and more like Emperor Commodus in Gladiator territory. Now to the comics. In issue 27, Rick, Glenn, and Michonne arrive at Woodbury, where the governor is very nice at first, but threatens to feed them to walkers if they don't give up their location. They're like,
hard no.
So the governor cuts Rick's hand off, Michonne bites the governor's ear off, and they're taken away, I presume by henchmen who are like, what the fuck happened in there? The governor later tortures Glenn, rapes Michonne, feeds Rick's hand to his dead niece Penny, and gets Rick to admit his people are staying in a nearby prison. You know, the Commodus comparison is really sticking now, so I feel like we should triple and maybe quadruple down. Let's go! So, Governor Commodus offers Michonne a role in his zombie arena in exchange for not being tortured. She agrees, kills her opponent and all the captive walkers, throws her sword into the crowd, asks if people are not entertained, meets a guy who's obsessed with gay giraffes, goes to Rome, has bloody adventures, fights a tiger, starts an uprising, and touches a shit ton of wheat. What really happens is Rick and Glenn break Michonne out, and then she makes a beeline for the governor's house and waits for him to get her revenge in maybe the most fucked up way possible. She cuts off his arm, scoops out his eye with a spoon that she put up his butt, nails his penis to a board, and makes him binge both seasons of the Friends spinoff Joey before leaving him worse off than Mr. Potato Head thrown in a tornado. Is she not merciful? While healing, the governor removes his dead niece's teeth, kisses her on the mouth, and vomits. Very, very normal behavior. Later, his main man Martinez is killed, and the governor uses his reanimated head to prove to his people the prison group are the bad guys. We would have settled for a quick PowerPoint presentation, but cool! And when the prison group attacks Woodbury, everybody's convinced it's time for all-out war! No, sorry, I mean it's time to kill them all! So they arrive at the prison with a tank and fire at them harder than Kylo did to Luke's Force Ghost in The Last Jedi.
More!
But like that movie, it somehow does nothing, he loses a ton of men, and it pisses off a lot of people for some reason. So they retreat, and one of his men, Gabe, brings him a captured Tyrese and Michonne's katana to prove she's dead. Narrator voice, she's not. So they return to the prison, and the governor says he'll spare Tyrese's life if they surrender, and they're like, nah. So he cuts off Tyrese's head with Michonne's katana. Later, Michonne ambushes them, and in the chaos, one of the governor's people shoots him in the face by accident. You know, by this point, he's basically that knight in Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
Come back here and take what's coming to you! Your legs off.
So he plows his tank through their fences, kills a bunch of people, like Herschel's son Billy, and then Herschel, who's overwhelmed with grief and asked to be killed. If that wasn't enough, the governor instructs his soldier Lily to kill Lori, which she does. But in one of the most holy shit moments of the series, and remember just seconds ago we talked about him getting his eye scooped out with a butt spoon, she kills little baby Judith in the process. After realizing she is in fact a baby killer, Lily shoots the governor in the back of the head, finally ending him and this part of the video. I could use a moment, maybe a bit of a palate cleanser. Can we show Strand in the beer bottle balloon real quick? Ugh. That's great. Fear the Walking Dead does not give a fuck. Now let's dive into the show. Philip Blake, played by British actor David Morrissey, had a much less complicated backstory than the novel and comics. Although he did have a brother, he never took on his identity. Prior to the apocalypse, Philip's wife died tragically in a car accident, leaving him and his daughter Penny to fend for themselves. When the apocalypse hit, they found their way to an abandoned town of Woodbury, where Philip took over, welcomed in new people, and opened a Dunkin' Donuts. Everything seemed to be going well until Penny died, causing the governor to go just a little over the edge. He keeps her as a walker pet, instructs his people to get supplies by going 17th century Britain on everyone's ass, and even creates a zombie apocalypse version of the Gulag from Warzone. Four wins there and you get a free box of munchkins. So there's that. It's around that time that he runs into Merle Dixon, who somehow survived and is back in the show. Like, they were gonna keep Michael Rooker on the bench. Come on, you gotta use him. The governor and his people find and capture Michonne and Andrea, who are taken to Woodbury and treated like guests.
Governor, they call you that?
Some nicknames stick whether you want them to or not.
Michonne isn't feeling it, so she takes her katana back and bails, while Andrea, who has a thing for the governor, joins him for a gladiator show. It's like medieval times, except here the Green Knight doesn't get me kicked out when I call him a whole-ass bitch. Later, Governor sends Merle and his boys out to kill Michonne.
We're doing a righteous public service here.
After they lie about doing so, they capture Glenn and Maggie, which is almost as good. The governor questions her like an 80s casting couch, it is very uncomfortable, and after threatening Glenn, gets her to spill the beans on the prison. All the while, Andrea's on wall duty, completely oblivious to the monster she's dating. Just like Varya in 90 Day Fiancé. Glenn and Maggie, who are now sentenced to die in the Screamer Pits, which was also the name of my high school Christian thrash metal band, get saved by Rick and the gang when they raid Woodbury. During the shootout, Oscar gets got, and the governor finds Michonne holding Penny hostage. Fresh out of fucks, Michonne kills zombie Penny and stabs the governor in the eye with a shard of glass. All things considered, dude, you got off light. Andrea shows up, has a face-off with Michonne like the roof scene in The Departed, and the governor holds his dead daughter. After getting stitched up, the governor rallies his people against the quote-unquote terrorists and announces he's captured Daryl and he's going to make him fight his traitor brother Merle. Are you not entertained? Rick and Maggie show up guns a-blazin' and rescue the Dixon Bros. Rather upset, the governor appoints Andrea as temporary leader and night manager of the Dunkin' Donuts, and he and his men march to the prison, where they shoot up the place and headshot Lou Temple, like a bunch of jerks. Fearing retaliation, the governor arms his people and lies to Andrea about what happened. Tyrese and Sasha, who now work for the governor, show up to give them intel on Rick while Andrea returns to the prison to tell Rick she belongs in Woodbury. Still, she nearly kills the governor in his sleep before she decides against it. Andrea sets up an in-person debate for Rick and the governor, which is full of arguing, personal attacks, and an offer to give up Michonne in exchange for leaving them alone. It gives Rick 2 days to decide, but once he's back in Woodbury, the governor tells his men to ambush them on their next meeting.
We'll have to eliminate Rick sooner or later.
Andrea escapes Woodbury again, but is captured by the governor and tied up. During the second meeting, Merle ambushes the governor's ambush with a very loud car, but quickly gets the shit kicked out of him by the Woodbury soldier. The governor bites off two of Merle's fingers and shoots him in the chest. Don't rub it. Then, he kills his top man Milton for betraying him and leaves him to reanimate in the room Andrea's being kept in. The wheels are falling off this bus! The governor and his people attack and infiltrate the prison but are quickly outnumbered and forced to retreat. Pissed at the people's cowardice, he murders most of them in a clearing, causing his most loyal followers to abandon him. So the governor burns down Woodbury and the last Dunkin' Donuts in existence, then spends the next few months surviving alone. Eventually, he finds a naive family to manipulate. Hey, it's Tara! He tells them his name is Brian, hey, that's his name in the comics, and quickly earns their trust by helping their dying father David, banging Tara's sister Lily, and saving their daughter Megan in a pit. They're then rescued by his old friend Martinez, who has a group of his own now. Personal growth! But the governor secretly kills him, and then secretly kills his successor Pete, and finally takes over as leader. The governor then captures Michonne and Herschel and convinces his people to help him take the prison, as Lily and Megan have a beach day. Now, if you listen to the popular podcast Talk Dead to Me, you know how this goes down. Rick proposes they live together, the governor calls him a liar, turns Herschel into nearly headless Nick, has a shootout, and Michonne has the play of the game against the governor and unlocks the Kruger operator and a new camo for her melee weapon. Lily, who just lost her daughter to a mudwalker, finally realizes the governor's a monster and finishes him off as the gang becomes scattered. It's also the last episode Beth and Maggie see each other alive. What a fun memory to hold on to. Following his death, we saw the governor one last time a season later as a hallucination as Tyrese is dying. The governor role was initially given to John Hawkes, best known for his role in Winter's Bone, which I'm told is an Academy Award-winning motion picture, and not, in fact, porn. However, he turned it down, saying he thought someone else would be better for the part. Also has a crippling fear of eye patches. So it was given to David Morrissey, who prepared by studying cult leaders Jim Jones and David Koresh and putting the severed heads of his neighbors in fish tanks. Turns out David Morrissey is quite method. The governor is still regarded as one of the best villains of the series to date. He's inspired merch, cosplays, and one of our favorite reactors.
You know, when you say it like that, it sounds like a bad thing.
And that wraps up this week's episode of I See Dead People. Where does the governor rank in your villain hierarchy? Would you let him keep your reanimated corpse in his den? And why is the answer yes? I'm Woody Zondorf. No one can tell me I can't rock this eye patch, though I do walk into a few doors, and I'll see you next time.
Hi there. They call me the governor. And I firmly believe that if the story had followed me, a man who brought a community together for safety against the biters, a man desperately searching for a cure for his daughter, then I would be the hero of the tale, and Rick and his crew would be the villains. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to go talk to a bunch of people who lost me a prison.